Hey everybody, Subtowner here with a brand new series of Endless Legend, where we are going to be playing as the Cultists, and I'm looking forward to it because, I've done a few test runs with the Cultists, and I have to say that they are extremely interesting and fun to play with. Only because they're, like, very different from all the other factions in the game, so that's probably why they're that, you know, interesting. And, before we start, I'll go through some of their traits and what they're all about, and I'll try to do this quickly, and we'll take a quick look at their units, and then we'll start this game up. So basically, the gist of the Cultists is that you cannot build settlers, you cannot settle new cities, you cannot even steal cities, because as soon as you take over a city, it's automatically razed. So that's what they're all about. So let's take a quick look here. High Seat of the Queen, which is one of our traits. No settler production, but we get plus one district level cap on cities. I'm not quite sure what that means, plus one district level cap on cities. I guess our districts can be one extra level higher than normal, I think is what that means. So that's sort of interesting. Not the most interesting thing, though. We also got this thing called the conversion, which this is actually pretty interesting. So we can convert pacified villages. Converted villages are lost for the original owner, so it's a good way to kind of like screw with your opponent. It gives all advantages of pacified villages to the new owner, no matter where they are on the map. I'm changing the words of what's written there, but yeah. So I mean, if the minor faction is like really far away on another, you know, in another region, you will still get the benefits if it's under your powers, basically. What else does it do? You also get six tiles of Fids plus the tile that the minor faction is on added to your capital. Since you only have one city, this is another great way of getting extra Fids so that, you know, your capital grows even bigger. So this is very important. This is like the main strategy with them is to really, you want to have as many minor factions under your control. Now, once we start the game, I'll explain why it's a little bit difficult to achieve that early on anyways, just because the AI opponent is not all that stupid when it comes to this, and I'll explain it more once we're in the game because it won't really make sense right now. Unless you've played the game as a Cultist, then you probably know what I'm talking about right now. And also, spawn a new unit, not retrofittable for the new owner. So there's a regularly spawns a new unit. So I guess I've tested them out, and I've done a lot of turns. I never actually got a free unit, so I'm not sure exactly how that works. But we're supposed to get free units. They're not retrofittable, though, but it is, it's a free unit that you can use as, you know, just a garbage unit, just to, like, you know, attack just random things, you know, because this is what they're all about. They're all about supremacy, as you can see up here. I probably should have mentioned that first, actually. And so that's what we're going to go for. We're going to go for the supremacy victory. I'm going to give myself a plan B, which is just a flat-out domination victory. So basically, the difference, if you're not familiar, supremacy, you pretty much have to destroy and annihilate everybody and be pretty much the only one left standing. As opposed to a domination victory, you only have to steal the capitals from your opponents. So it's a little bit easier to do a domination victory. In fact, the supremacy victory makes sense for these guys because, like I said, you cannot... actually, you know what? I forgot one of the traits here. Weapons of the enemy. I was going to say you cannot steal cities, right? So you can't accidentally, you know, win an expansion victory, because sometimes when you're, you know, trying for supremacy victory, you're keeping every city you're taking over, then you forget that, oops, if you grab 75% of the regions, you win the game, right? Well, it can happen with the Cultists, and this is why, and this is what happens when you capture a city. I forgot to mention this, I don't know why I did. A captured city is immediately razed, and you get plus one industry stockpile per population when a city is raised. So if the city had, like, say, 5 pop when you raised it, you're going to get 5 industry stockpiles. Now, these industry stockpiles, at least in the early stages of the game, are only worth 25 industry. I don't know if that gets, you know, better as the game progresses or if it's based on eras. I'm not sure. But it is 25 industry per stockpile. So if you're raising a whole lot of cities, you are going to get a lot of industry that way, too. We're going to go through the units real quick, but let me just finish here. We got the Cultist main quest, which is a big deal. I mean, honestly, not a big deal, I should say. I do the main quests for, you know, when I play these games, but I mean, I don't know. It's not like I'm following the lore or anything like that. Language Square is usually the tech I go for first. We actually start with it, which makes sense for them. I am going to try something different this time, though, with the cultists, and I'll explain it when I actually start the game up. I think I've been going at it all wrong. Anyways, and we also get the military science tech right off the bat, which, I mean, you have to actually build this. So, I mean, early on, I don't really have the time to build it, but obviously, since we only get one city, you're definitely going to want to beef it up as, you know, strongest as possible, just in case an enemy goes, you know, crazy aggressive, which in this game they don't tend to go crazy aggressive. They go stupid aggressive sometimes. But anyways, we'll get into that when I start the game. So basically we get a settler unit. The reason why we get a settler unit here is because we actually have to found our capital right off the bat, right? And after that, you'll never get settlers ever again. You'll never have the possibility of settlers. So, I mean, when you're first playing, you're probably a little bit confused by this. At least I was. I was like, why did we get a settler? I thought they couldn't build settlers. But no, it's because you have to create your first city. We also get the preacher unit, which I actually like a lot, just because of his abilities. And I can't actually, you know, put my cursor over it right now on this screen, but once we start the game, I'll explain why. The unleash potential is really cool, really strong. And, I mean, overall, these units are pretty weak, but it's all about buffing and, you know, slowing down your opponents, pretty much, is what they're all about. So they're a very good support unit. We also get the fanatic, which is a cavalry unit. You know what? I can't make this thing work. I for starters, I don't like cavalry units in this game. I like my infantry unit, you know, defending three range units, because I think range units in this game are really, really strong, and you probably should just go range pretty much. But you do have to defend the range units, because usually range units are pretty squishy. So, but no, I mean, besides having a lot of hit points, I mean, 124 hit points for an Era 1 unit. This is our unit that we actually have to tech for. We start with the Preacher, but we have to actually tech this guy. And because we have to tech him, I think I might just bypass him altogether. I'm going to try to make other things work out when we start the game there. But anyways, I mean, if you're interested in cavalry units, we get a cavalry unit. This is the unit we really want, though, the Nameless Guard, which is a ranged unit. We got range 3, we got the point blank power 1, block 1, which is very standard for, you know, a ranged unit. Overall damage is pretty good at 44 when it starts out, 59 attack, which is pretty good, and we can easily buff these guys to be much stronger with our preachers, with the unleash potential. And we start with a hero that's an infantry unit, so yeah, it all points out to wanting to get the Era 2 as fast as possible and to, you know, pop these guys out. And at that stage, that's when we're going to go on our rampage and just start, you know, destroying every single city that we encounter, right? So that's pretty much the goal. Besides that, I mean, that's pretty much it. So we're going to go ahead and start this up. Let me just go back, though. Yeah, let's select this. Just a, you know, quick look at what we're going to be doing here in the game. I'm going to keep it on serious difficulty. I've actually been testing out the cultists on Impossible. And, yeah, I was getting sort of crushed because the cultists, like I said, they're very different than the other factions. So I'm actually just going to stick to Sirius, which was what my last series was, where I played as the Volters and went for a scientific victory. So if you're interested in that, I'll post a link to the playlist in case you missed it. Maybe you'd be interested in checking that out. Game speed, we're going to keep normal. Advanced settings, we're not going to bother. World size 6. I am going to play on a large Pangea since we are going for a Supremacy victory. Although, if I was to play on Impossible, I'd probably go, you know, large continents. But, because I've noticed the AI on Impossible on a large Pangea, man, they definitely start with a settler, that's for sure. Well, I mean, two settlers, I think. But, yeah, I mean, after 25 turns, or not even 20 turns, a lot of times they already have three regions settled. Like, you know, playing just normally, you can't do that, really. I mean, that'd be very hard to achieve, to be able to settle three cities that quickly, not to mention the unhappiness you'd get from that. But they obviously get a better, you know, unhappiness bonus, or happiness bonus on the higher difficulties. But yeah, we're going to keep that on serious. Anyway, so large Pangea, we're going to go, well, continent shape shouldn't really technically matter if we're playing on a large Pangea. We're going to keep the temperature temperate, which is, you know, gives us a balance of everything. Then again, since we're playing as the cultist, I could really screw around with everybody, and I could just go for what I would want a chance for, right? Since we only get one region, you know, I could mess around with this. Temperate is almost considered random terrain, right? Because every region can be different, although the north is usually the more arctic-y type things. But yeah, I'm actually, I'm not quite sure what I need the most of. I think money. Money as the cultist is extremely valuable. I'd probably go for something like this. Slightly better in dust and worse in science, jungle and desert environments with some grassland. You know, we don't really need to be teching all that quickly. I almost feel like going arid. You know what? I feel like doing that. I'm going to do that. Actually, I'm going to screw the AI on this one. I'm going to go arid. We're going to just go crazy money. It might screw me over as well. We'll find out. But anyways, so topography, we're going to keep the same. World difficulty, we're going to keep on normal. Like I've mentioned in the other series, is that hard. Basically, is the equivalent of Civ 5's Raging Barbarian, so I don't want anything like that. Let's just keep it normal, and that's pretty much it. So let's start this up. We'll take a quick look at the cutscene as well.
The Endless broke us when they broke themselves. Now we are few, and many that remain are of little use. Yet our purpose still drives us. Even death cannot be allowed to stop us. We must find new converts, new servants, who will help us fulfill the great oaths we took so long ago. They will not only be our hands and our eyes, they will be the sword and the shield of our armies that will bring the eternal end. First upon Auriga, and then across the universe.
Alright, so there you go. That is the cutscene. So we got the Draken in our game, or Draken. Someone mentioned to me in my other series that the reason why I always get this pop-up is because that's one of the abilities of the Draken, is that they know where all the capitals are, so they automatically know where everybody is, so they're probably very good for a diplomatic victory without, you know, they don't really have to explore the whole world to know where everybody is. So that was actually kind of interesting, but we're going to dismiss this. So this is the area we get. This is not very arid. It looks very luscious and beautiful. Anyways, so that was the cutscene, actually. I wasn't really paying attention to it, so hopefully someone learned something from that cutscene. But so yeah, there is a river. So basically, all right, I mean, forget the cutscene. Forget all that stuff. Let's stick to what's important right now. And what's important is that we only get one shot at settling our city. Now, a lot of people tend to want to spend as many turns as it takes, you know, as needed to find the perfect spot. I sort of disagree with this, especially if you're playing on the higher difficulties. You don't want to be wasting more than 3 or 4 turns looking for a spot. I mean, if you're going more than that, you're probably just screwing yourself, especially if you're playing on the higher difficulties. Now, right off the bat, I can notice that we got a river. Now, this river is going to be extremely important for us. I definitely want to get it on our side. In fact, I might just settle here. I mean, there's not a lot. Well, this is a nice tile over here, but I'd be too far from the river. We can always create burrows, though, that will go there. But one thing's for sure is that we're going to separate our guys here. So let's grab this guy, and we'll plop him here. I can't plop him. You got to be shitting me. What the fuck? There we go. Plop him here. Oh, cool. We got these guys. Oh, man. And they got an infantry unit, which is what I need. I was going to talk about that. Since I don't want the our cavalry unit, which I don't think is all that good, I do want an infantry unit, and this is awesome that these guys give the infantry unit. Plus, we get plus 5% per pacified thingamajigger there, so we're definitely going to go pacify these guys right away, and that was another part of my strategy. A lot of times I parlay, but for the first minor faction, the one that's in your region, bribe it. Give it money, get it over with. They automatically join you. You get the workers or the citizens that it will give you immediately in your city. Look at all these nice spots here. Anyway, so that's my 2 cents on that. So we're gonna do that. Look, there's some pretty interesting spots over here. See, this is the arid stuff. Again, it's not a lot of production though. That's the problem. But then again, down here it's just trees as well. Can I grab this now? No, I can't grab it on this turn. And we're also gonna plop this guy out. I don't think I'll be able to plop him out anywhere interesting, though. See, it's going to force me to plop him there because of the stupid where we started. What? Oh, there we go. Okay. So this guy, I guess, we'll send down here, obviously. See what else we get. Pretty good tiles. This is a 4 and 5 over here. These escaped specimens are a pretty good tile. 4 and 5, that's a lot of money. Definitely money is very important. This is a nice tile over here as well. I'm actually going to send our hero guy right now to talk to this guy. Now, I don't know what happens if I'm not settled and I parlay. Actually, I don't have the money right now, so I'm not going to talk to him just yet. I'm going to wait till I get my city, and we're going to save up. I think it's going to be like 150 gold needed. I want to find as many of these things as possible. This is a pretty good tile here. These are pretty good tiles, too. There's a lot of science here, a lot of gold. Not a lot of growth, though, which is a little bit concerning. Down here, there's definitely more growth, good money, decent science. You know what? I think I'm going to settle right here, actually. It'll give me these starting tiles. Then I can just burrow in directions that I really need to be going in. I mean, I'm going to reach everything. We're going to want to burrow as much as possible, right? So really, that's another reason why the starting location isn't always that huge. Now, I'm actually going to shut up now and continue, end this turn. I'm sure there's someone out there screaming at the TV or the screen saying, hey, just, you know, settle your goddamn city. But you know what? You know what, buddy? You're probably correct, and I will try to do that as soon as possible. But, yeah, let's at least grab this here. This is a really nice tile, but after that, it's pretty garbage. This is a nice tile, too. There's all nice tiles everywhere. Right, we didn't get anything out of that one, so that sucks. See, the thing when you separate your guys is that we're losing a lot of money now because they're all three considered an army right now, right? So the maintenance on armies or on units is based on armies. If they're actually garrisoned, they don't cost anything. So keep that in mind. This is actually, I'm starting to think this is probably the best spot to settle. There's not a lot of food, though, but it's just got a beefy amount of everything else. Like, I mean everything else. Can I settle on this thing, you think? This gives happiness too, eh? Oh, this too? There's two happiness things? Right, no, I have no choice. I'm gonna try to settle on this thing, actually. Then I could just start burrowing maybe more down that way. So I'm gonna actually send this hero right away up here. Because I've made up my mind that this is certainly the strongest spot to settle, actually. There's just a good amount of science, good amount of money. Just really weak on production, though, which is actually, now that I think of it, maybe not the best spot to settle. Maybe more here. I get the river. And then after that, I can start burrowing to grab the anomalies, which I think is what I'm going to do. I need some production. I can't neglect the production right now. So anyways, I'm going to send this guy down. We're looking for runes, basically, with our guys. If you don't find a lot of runes, then you're going to find yourself, you know, wasting a lot of time. Oh, there's another one of these guys. Oh, he's in the other region. This is actually a pretty good spot, too. This is really nice. Good science, good production. Okay-ish food. It's always tough to settle. There's always good spots everywhere. I mean, it's so frustrating because you want to settle everywhere. It's not going to happen, though. Is everybody moved? No, you're not done moving. Might as well start going in another region. Oh, you're not done moving. Who over here? I might as well parlay with these guys now. Anyways, okay, so next turn we'll settle. I mean, honestly, three turns. I mean, you don't want to go much more than that. I mean, make a choice. Settle. Now it's just a matter of settling in the right spot right here. I mean, I get okay production. Actually, if I settle here, I can always go burrow on that side after. Create a burrow on the other side. And create a burrow there, and I can level the city center. Yeah, because right here, I mean, I get the happiness right off the bat. I get three hammers, which is not much, but honestly, what can you do? We get the river. Get a good amount of science, good amount of food right away. I'm going to do it. Not sure it's the ultimate spot, but it's going to have to do. All right, we found another minor faction, so that's interesting. Now, what are we going to queue up here? Well, obviously, we're going to go for the Founder's Memorial. My nose was itchy, and it was bothering me. So Founder's Memorial, we're at plus 9 gold. We lost a lot of money, though. See, I haven't been finding any runes, so that's the downfall. We're going to stick on growth for now. And I think this guy can still move. Yes, he can. So that's the trick. So that normally you can't have just a hero moving around, technically speaking. So this is the only opportunity you'll ever get to really get a hero to move around on his own. So that's, you know, a lot of scouting power right now. But we're not finding any runes, which is a little bit annoying. I'm just going to zoom out in case I miss something. No. Oh, actually, we get some glass steel here. Doesn't look like we have anything else, though. No, doesn't look like it, but glass steel could come in handy for sure. Can I move this guy? We don't want to move too far away. We're going to want to get these guys back together. We got about 20 turns before the minor faction starts spewing out units. So also keep that in mind. I might as well... I'll take a chance, go this way. There we go, we found another one. Another minor faction. Now, I was talking about in the intro there how, you know, important and valuable it's going to be to get all the minor factions. Now, problem is that when you, you know, convert a minor faction that's on another region, it is under your color, but the AI will never hesitate but to attack it again. And if you attack, if it gets attacked and gets killed, you have to start the whole process again, and it costs a lot of influence to get them on your side. So that's another thing we're going to need a lot of is influence. So keep that in mind. Oh, I didn't choose a tech. So what are we going to go? We're going to go for the basic stuff. I'm definitely going to go for the mill foundry first, then the seed storage, then the money, then the science thing. After that, we'll come back and figure out what we want to do. We'll definitely probably want the tier ones of these advanced weapons, although we only have glass steel, but that's fine enough, because we're definitely going to want to be strong, right? We're all about supremacy and all that crap, so we're going to want to make sure we're strong. I think with our anomalies, we won't really need the sewer system ever. Like, ever. I don't think I'll need to get it. Improved search on runes, I don't really care. So yeah, I mean, it's obviously going to want the extractors, but I don't think we even need these ones. I don't think we have a luxury resource. We do have glass steel, so you know what? I will queue you up next. There we go. So those are going to be the five first techs. Then we got also, we have to convert two minor factions to progress, you know, through our quest line. So we're going to want to do that. Obviously.
Duh.
All right, 40 dust. Beautiful. Like I said, I don't want this guy to go too far. In fact, I'll just go here on this hill, see if there's a quick rune that I can spot. There isn't. So I'm going to start swinging this guy back. Probably parlay with this guy here. You know what? Our hero can move all the way down there. Good. There's a rune. Excellent. And I'm going to swing him back as well. Ah, man. I'm not getting lucky on the runes. It also looks like we only have one minor faction on our region. So that's a bit of a bummer. Do I parlay with you yet? Because you get experience if a hero's with you. And I'm not in a real hurry to parlay, to be quite honest. We can do that after, because I'm not going to be, you know, wandering too far away from my main area until I'm, you know, quite strong, right? So, because if you wander away too fast, it just becomes a little bit complicated as the cultist. You just can't get things done. I'm actually going to make this the last turn. I know it was a little bit of a slow-paced thing. It was more of an explanation type of thing. But in the next episode, we're definitely going to ramp up the speed here and start doing what we got to do. Let's grab this rune here, too. Man, I'm really, really not getting lucky here, man. Fuck me. Christ. Usually I get way, way more money than this. See, that's when it becomes like, well, was it worth doing? I actually cannot... I can't... Really? I have to go all the way like that. Well, I might as well grab this rune. We have found the greens. Weren't the greens the... Whatchamacallits? The draken? Yes, they were. Cool. I don't think they're that aggressive, so we should be okay. And let's move our hero back in this direction, and we'll call it a cut for this episode. Thanks for watching, everybody, and like I said, in the next one, you know, there should be a little bit more action than right now, but hopefully... You know, you got a better idea of how the cultists work, although we haven't really done much. I don't think it's really settled in yet how they work exactly. Wow, we're not getting good hammers. I just realized 16 turns, man. That's fucking horrible. Definitely going to have to build the mill foundry. Oh, we're teching like crazy, though. Yeah, we got crazy tech, which is not a bad thing. But we got weak production. So we're going to want to start creating burrows. And see, money's going to be very valuable. We're not making all that much money either right now. So I really chose tech over everything else the way... Maybe it wasn't a great spot, now that I think of it. Anyways, whatever. Thanks for watching, everybody. See you all in the next one.